The creation of jobs is one important policy objective of agreements like TTIP. But under what conditions do these kinds of agreements typically create new jobs? We assume that a broad agreement will be reached. In addition to dealing with tariffs, we think it will also largely eliminate non-tariff trade barriers between the EU and the US. This outcome would, however, produce winners and losers in terms of employment, unemployment, and real income. Clear winners include Ireland, Portugal, the United Kingdom, and, of course, the United States. Losers, on the other hand, include traditional trading partners of both parties, such as Australia or Canada for the US, or, here in Europe, countries like Norway or Turkey. But overall, the transatlantic trade and investment partnership could mean 2 million additional jobs for the countries of the OECD. Maybe one of the most important questions to ask is whether a free trade agreement between the EU and the US would be more likely to strengthen or endanger the economic and political cohesion of the EU. To begin examining this issue, we look at how trade activity in the European domestic market would change as the result of a transatlantic trade and investment partnership. An agreement would admittedly result in an expansion of transatlantic trade. But at the same time, trade activity in the domestic market would decline. Here we'll show you the relationship using the example of Germany. While trade redirection effects remain minor in a simple tariff scenario, they are very distinct in the case of a far-reaching trade liberalization. You can see that the volume of trade between Germany and the US would increase by around 94%, almost doubling. In contrast, trade between Germany and England would decline by over 40%. And trade between Germany and France would also decline by a good 23%. German trade with southern European countries would drastically decline as well, by approximately 30% in each case. Thus, it appears that some countries in the EU domestic market will become more economically independent of their European neighbors. Since the European domestic market has been a milestone for the European integration movement and a key tool to bind countries together, one needs to ask at this junction whether the political integration of Europe might suffer from reduced cohesion of the domestic market. Will only the strong, rich countries profit from this kind of agreement? Or will the poor, crisis-ridden countries of Southern Europe profit as well? Will a transatlantic trade and investment partnership deepen the divide between poor and rich? This map shows the increase in real income per capita in the case of a far-reaching agreement. When just economics are considered, it can be seen that the Southern European countries are significantly above the European average of 5%. And would therefore also profit appreciably more from a transatlantic trade and investment partnership than Germany, Austria, or Holland, for example. Now let's look at it in a different way. In this motion chart, you see all EU member countries in the form of points or bubbles. The size of the bubble indicates the size of the country's population. So, for example, Germany is a large bubble, and Lithuania, a small bubble. A transatlantic trade and investment partnership would result in additional growth in real income per capita. This additional percent is mapped out on the vertical axis on the left. The higher a country is on this axis, the more it will profit from an agreement. On the horizontal axis, which is a logarithmic scale, we see income per capita. Richer countries are further to the right, and poorer countries are closer to the origin. In this chart, we are looking at the probable result of a tariff union alone. This chart does not illustrate the likely result of a far-reaching agreement. This graph illustrates an interesting and statistically significant relationship. The poorer a country is, the more it would profit from a tariff union. Let's also look at the same chart with a far-reaching agreement, which includes abolition of non-tariff trade barriers. As you can see, the gains in economic growth are now markedly higher in general. And although this correlation is not statistically significant, there is a notable relationship. In conclusion, it seems that an agreement is unlikely to deepen the economic divisions in Europe by widening the gap between poor and rich EU countries.